Okay, so yeah, I work for a company called Leonidas. This talk is about teamwork, but I'll leave the work part out of it. So like, I'll be focusing on how teams, like what are the relationships within teams, and I'll be not talking about how to organize teamwork, like, you know, Kanban and Scrum, and I don't have anything to talk about that stuff, but I'll be talking about how teams work generally. And hopefully it will give you tools to make your team work in a simple, effective way. This is the talk, so that once you've read this, you can go and leave if you want to. What I'm going to say is that feeling of fairness and communal sharing are the basis of teamwork. But it requires rapport because it's a very fragile thing. Then I'll give you a bunch of tips and show you some anti-patterns that hinder the development of teamwork. And if you look at these tips, I will tell you to meet outside work, be close to each other, have rituals and be naked. So basically, I will tell you to go to sauna, but I'll also teach you how you can do this same stuff outside sauna, and hopefully, in that way get the same benefits. On the anti-pattern side, I don't know if this choice of words works outside Finland, but I will about these anti-patterns and people who apply them, I only have to say that there's still plenty of room behind the sauna where you can bury all this stuff. Okay, so have any of you heard about relational models theory? No? Okay, good. So this is a very basic theory in anthropology. Just my microphone a bit. So, can you hear me? Okay, good. Okay, and it says that there are four basic types of relationships that we all the people share, and these are models inside our brains about how we approach all relationships that we have in our lives, and there are only four. So this is an exhaustive list. And there is quite a bit of empirical evidence about this theory from all sides of life and from many cultures. So this is universal, and it's useful for us. I'll be relying on this theory. I'm not saying that what I will say here is scientific stuff. This is most of my opinions and my experiences, but I'll be building it on top of this theory. So that's why I'll explain this theory. But don't think that because it has this theory behind it, it's scientific and it must be true. So have a healthy bit of skepticism against everything I say. Okay. So the four models of relationships. First one is communal sharing. It means that the group of people who are applying this model of relationship have something in common, and they feel that in that part of the relationship that they are such a community that really anyone is equal to another, and that they can make decisions based on on that notion that something that is good for someone of that community, then it's good for everyone, right? And examples of that: family, very nationalistic nations, then very tightly knit groups, and best teams. Then there's authority ranking, which means that there is an authority, and there are people who have different ranks. So some people are more important than the others. So, or someone had more authority than the others. So, for example, a parent and a child. So, you know, parent can say that we will do this. Or old people and young people, like in certain social events, like it is customary to, you know, bow to old people, depending on culture. And in some cultures there are more of this kind of stuff, and in some cultures there are less. And then there's equality matching, which means that everyone is equal, and everyone should get an equal portion of the thing. So, for example, again from the family, like if one child says that, or if one child gets an ice cream, then it's, you know, common that another child will also get an ice cream, and that's fair, right? But then in some different situations, fairness is something else. And then there's market pricing, which means that like there is a different things have different values, and then we are looking for a ratio between different things, and finding the optimal ratio that we can trade upon. And so a lot of business revolves around this thing. Okay, so an example, 4 ways to pay salary. Obviously authority ranking by rank and seniority. Like, so if you've been longer in the company, or if you're a boss, then you should get more pay. Equality matching is easy also, like everyone gets the same salary. Market pricing, by market value, so if you're more important to the company, you should get more salary. Or practically it means that whoever is a good negotiator gets more salary, right? And then communal sharing. What would communal sharing be? Like how would the salary be paid in communal sharing? Yeah, a bunch of money, and everyone can use that money. So there's no real salary. There's just common pool of money. Right. Okay, and of course in modern setting you rarely see this kind of thing, but. Like in some other cultures in older times, this was perhaps more common. Okay, so now question, what is fair? Like what is a fair way to pay salary? What do you think? Okay, so let's see, how many would say that communal sharing is a fair way to pay salary? Okay. What about authority ranking? Okay, go for it. Okay. Equality matching? Market pricing? Plenty of people. Okay. Yeah. So, yeah, I think the correct answer is that it depends. And it's for different situations, for different people, the fair has a different meaning. And perhaps a more interesting approach is to ask, what is unfair? And let's have a look at that. So sometimes there's a model mismatch. Let's say I and Ari. Ari is having some trouble, as usual, and he's in need of money. And, I'm a friend of Ari. I loan money to Ari. Yeah. So what do you think is the fair, like, what are the fair payment terms in that situation? Like, so, you know, we can have these two models in our head. I think that, you know, I want a fair interest rate. We're friends, but and Ari is expecting to pay back what he loaned and nothing more. So what do you think is fair? Who says that the one on the left is fair? Right? And who says the one on the right is fair? Okay. So I mean, yeah. So I'd say that most people, really, in our culture, in this situation, I wouldn't expect Ari to pay me interest rate. Right. It's because friendship is supposed to go beyond that. Like we don't expect interest from our friends, and that's part of our culture. Right? It's common in our culture that we don't get interest from our friends, and that's why, like, doing business with friends, there's always that some kind of, like, you know, are we really doing business or are we being friends? And that's difficult, and it can lead to a lot of trouble. So, model mismatch is what's unfair. So this is what is unfair, like that I have a different idea of what is the pattern, what is the model in this situation than Ari has. Right? So we have different ideas, and we that both of us get a different idea of what is fair, and then when they clash, then that feels unfair for both of us. Okay. And that kills the cooperation between us. So it's really, like, if we get stuck in this situation, it's really hard for me and Ari to do anything that relates to money anymore. Okay. And it's the feeling of unfairness. It's not the unfairness per se. There is no unfairness per se. It is always the feeling of unfairness. And the reason why I'm talking about this unfairness is because it's really important, because you need to have the feeling of fairness to cooperate with people. Right? And, okay. Okay, let's talk about decision making. And again, example of these, how these different models look like when we are making decisions. What do they mean? Like communal sharing, when we are sharing everything, we are sharing the knowledge and we are sharing the decision, it's really a consensus. Authority ranking means that the boss says that you do this. Equality matching means that everyone gets a fair, like the same amount of something. Maybe they vote, or if Ari makes this decision, then I'll get to make the next decision. Something like that. And market pricing, that really comes down to an argument. Like, we have two things, we have to find the ratio between them, and so we need to find the arguments balance, or get the right balance between them so that the ratio is correct. And the thing is that each of these, like, has its value, but what matters is that we all know that in what situation we are using which of these models. So that if I come to one situation and I expect that we are voting about it, and you expect that it's a consensus, or more common, like this is what I see often, I expect that it's a consensus, someone else expects that it's an argument, then it's really hard to make a decision. And that's what we are talking about. So let's say we are deciding what feature to develop next. You think that it's a consensus, I think that it's an argument. Like I already have two options in my mind, and now we are arguing which one is the one that we are going to develop. Like, are we going to develop that feature or that feature? So that leads to feeling of unfairness and no cooperation. How does it look like? Like, what are the arguments that we use when we talk about consensus decision making or argument? What kind of conversation we have there? Well, consensus means that we have a set of premises, and we have to, like, because we are sharing this, we are making this decision collectively, that we share these premises, then the conclusions that we draw from these must be something that can be drawn from those premises alone. Right? And everyone, really, could be able to make that same conclusion based on those same premises. Whereas with argument, we already have a set of conclusions and we are trying to find premises that support them. Okay. So the first point that I wanted to introduce to this model, and then I wanted to introduce to you the fact that it is the mismatch between the models when we come to some situation, some relationship, that causes the strain between people, the feeling of unfairness, and that is something that kills cooperation. So now the question becomes, what is the best way to work in a team? Is it that decision making within the community within the team, a communal decision making, or is it maybe author ranking, or is it market pricing? And like there will be situations, like regardless of what we choose here, there will be situations in our team, in our company, where we need to use something else, and it is important to know those situations, and then apply the right model in those situations. So for example, like if we decide that okay, we are all equal in this team and that's how we communicate, when you go talk to your boss about your salary, you're probably going to use market pricing with your boss. So it's like this, it could be even the same people, you and your boss could be in the same team, but when you're talking about salary, then it's a talk, that's it, then it's a conversation that uses market pricing. Okay, but like some model of some, these models have different properties, and so we should strive to use some of them in certain situations. And now the question is, what is the best model for teamwork? Something that we should strive to use in most situations. And well, I've already said it a few times now that it's the communal sharing that, in my opinion, is what the good teams base their communication on. So, all of them are needed to an extent, but communal sharing is the simplest and most effective when it works. The problems with this is authority ranking, well, it doesn't really utilize team members' abilities, because like we are in an information business, right? We are handling information, which means that we are basically making decisions all the time. If we hand over the important decisions to our boss, then it means that our like decision-making abilities are not really utilized. And that's the problem with authority ranking. With equality matching, the problem is that it's not really based on either the merit of the idea of the problem that we are trying to solve or the solution, and it's not based on the merit of the people either. Like authority ranking is somehow based on the merit of the people. Market pricing is based on the merit of the idea, hopefully, and communal sharing too, hopefully. But equality matching is not really based on merit, it's just based on people's votes. And so like this, you know, democracy works in some places, not in every place. That's basically the point here. And market pricing, it has two problems. It's a very heavy mechanism. Like when you have to do the like cost-benefit analysis for every decision, that takes a lot of time, a lot of energy. Another problem with that is that it doesn't bring the inherent joy that the other relationships bring. So with communal sharing, you have that feeling of the group, that feeling of belonging to something. With authority, you either get the feeling of being the boss or having a good boss, you know, in the best case. And that's like even like the latter part, it's a warm feeling when you feel that I'm safe, I have a good boss. Equality matching, like that's the feeling of brotherhood or feeling of justice. Like if someone insults me, I can insult him back. If someone kills my brother, I can kill his brother. It's equality matching is very common in cultures as a reason for violence. Like the violence often revolves around equality matching. So that, you know, if something like the rules for violence are the rules of revenge. That if something happens to me, then I can revenge that. Okay. But of course, like it had like, you know, democracy is also part of like equality matching. So it's not that these are good or bad, but it's like these are applied in different situations. So, market pricing doesn't bring inherent joy, and this is now this has research behind it. So the point is how to move towards this communal sharing. What kind of tricks? What kind of tools do we have to move towards communal sharing so that our team works in this mode as much as possible? In all the cases, in all the situations where this is the good mode to work. Right. And the problem is it's very fragile. It's like it's the one that requires most trust in others, and the kind of the human relationships default to the others. Like it's market pricing is really when you have nothing in common and you have to deal with someone, then you negotiate. You negotiate and you find a fair price. Like when you go to when you go to buy something, new shoes, and you negotiate, you don't know the person who's selling stuff there. You try to find the fair price or good price, and you're very happy if you get the good price and you get the joy of that. You don't get the inherent joy of from the negotiation. That was regarding the previous point, but so. If you're here and you don't have that trust that builds the community, then you default to here or here or here, and it's hard to make the team work, or the team doesn't work as well. And so this specific kind of trust that I'm talking about, I think the best word for that is rapport. So rapport. The feeling that you're in sync, the feeling that you're in the same boat, in the same team, and the feeling that you understand each other. So it is not about not about trusting the ability of someone. It is not about trusting that he will do what I tell him to do. Those are like that would be the first one would be a market pricing perhaps. The other one would be about authority, like someone being a good subordinate. The trust I'm talking about is about being in a community and feeling that you are part of the same community. Right. Okay. And so here are the tips. And go to sauna part. So, meet outside work. I went to India last week. I came back a week ago. I was there 10 days. I've never been to India. I was very nervous. I hadn't met any of the people I met there. I went to consult in a company. I'd never met anyone there, so I arrived on Thursday. Then on Friday, I talked briefly with these guys. I mostly work with other guys. Kapil here, at the end of Friday, he asked what I'm doing on weekend, and what should we go to see some sites. And I was, yes, I don't have anything to do in India for the weekend, and I don't know anyone. I would so much like to go see the sites with someone who knows them. And the feeling that I got from that is that I really want to work with these people, and I hope that I can do more stuff in that company because of that thing. Another thing that he did that was great was that when I called him on Saturday, we were going out on Sunday, I called him on Saturday and I said, I'm very thankful and all that, I hear Indians do. and he said that, don't say that. I got the feeling that he didn't want me to be anyone else besides myself. And that was very important. I have a friend, and I can be myself around when we go see the sites and stuff. And we went to have dinner a couple of times and so on. So, that's what I'm talking about. When you meet someone outside work and you have the courage to reach out to someone who comes from outside the team, then you really build this feeling that we are here together and. Okay, so that's one. Have rituals. There's another. When I came back from India, I didn't go home. I went to have a party with these guys. We were in the same team a few years ago, and now the project that we were working on was finally handed over to another company. This was a good team, and so that's why I have a picture of it here. And part of the thing that made it good was that we had a lot of rituals, stupid little things that made us feel that this is our stuff and no one else's. So we had a habit of going to this hamburger restaurant, it was really a pub, so we drank beer and ate hamburgers for lunch on Fridays. And the ritual was that this guy, Tuomas here, he always told the same joke. It was a stupid joke. I'm not going to tell it here, but it's like that was the ritual. Another ritual there was that we had this flower, and it's a dancing flower. So you know, it, every morning at 9:30, you know, it went on and so that was our call to the scrum meeting, and you know, that's something that like we will always remember that tune, and you know, so that flower has a lot of special meaning to us, and that's something that unites us, and all kinds of this kind of like culture that's only shared by that team. And I think it's very important to build the feeling of community in the team, and you know, so that it tricks us thinking that we can trust these guys because we are in the same team. And it's, I mean when I say trick, I mean in the best possible sense, that we are tricking ourselves because we know that we people tend to be very like mistrusting about or distrusting towards others. So we have the tendency to think that like be suspicious. And we want to break that barrier. We want to make it easy for ourselves to think that we are in the same community, same team. And that's what this flower was about. We didn't think about it that way, but that's what it's achieved. And you can see Otto smiling back there because of the flower. Or maybe because of the beer. Okay, be close to each other. This is the... We just moved to a new office, Leonidas. We are 18 people. The new office continues there, like it's about this size. So this is about three times as large as the previous one. So there's plenty of room for us now. And where do you think we all sit? Like, oh. We sit in these two rooms. It's almost all of us sit in these two rooms. It's just like it's so nice to be next to each other and you know, be able to talk to each other and you know, we have a sofa there and the bookshelf there or something, and you know, and although it's really crowded when we all there, that's like where people tend to go. Like we have tables all there and there, and we'll be renovating that so that it will be very different. But like, everyone seems to like, gravitate around these two rooms. Okay. Okay. Then the be naked part, and this I think is kind of a, like more high level than the previous ones, and also more important. And the previous ones are kind of tools to reach this. So and this is much about rapport as well. So. Each of these models implies a certain personal appearance, and well, except the communal sharing, and like when you have authority, your authority ranking is based on the fact that you have authority, and you want to look like you have the authority. Like you have to make it felt that you have the authority. So then it's easy to use authority ranking. As a tool, as the model for conversation or a relationship. Equality matching, that's about the honor, like that we are equal and like we have this honor, like this bond of brotherhood or something, that or you know, being colleagues, that I want you to respect me because I'm a software developer. Yeah? Like, as a software developer, I want you to respect me. That kind of stuff. And there's like market pricing, that's based on the economics, and the assumption is that all agents in market are rational, and so you want to like your arguments when you're in a conversation, and the model is market pricing. They are more effective if you appear to be a rational being. And like all of these are a burden, because you have to maintain these. I'd say like maintaining authority is taking part away from a real conversation. And when you maintain that authority, it also means that like even like if you appear to be like if you have that aura of authority, and like you are meant to be here in communal sharing in this relationship, it's automatically kind of moves the relationship towards the authority ranking. So that's why like you need to be naked, like tear down those codes of authority and stuff, and that's it's easier to be in the communal sharing mode. And so here are examples, like within the team, for example, MBTI, you know, Myers-Briggs type in inference, in what's that? Okay, Myers-Briggs, you know, who knows Myers-Briggs? Okay, so it's the psychological tool that like an analysis about what kind of person you are, and a lot of teams do these so that they know each other better. Like, he is that kind of a person, I'm this kind of a person. We know better who we are, and so like we kind of get more close to each other or understand each other better, and those codes of authority, for example, disappear. You know, another thing is tell something embarrassing about yourself. So this is a tool I sometimes use with teams, like within the team. Tell something embarrassing about yourself. I tell you something embarrassing, and you tell me something embarrassing about yourself. That's two meanings. Like, you know that I'm a human being. Like, I make mistakes, and like I don't have to appear to not be making mistakes anymore. And then we have a kind of common secret that makes our group closer, right? Because we share that, and we don't share that with the others. So it means that we are closer. Tell about your life. It doesn't have to be that complicated. But most importantly, be yourself and trust others. You have to show trust to others so that they trust you. Like it takes courage to trust others. Show that you know I can tell stuff about myself. I can be myself, and then it's easier for others to be, you know, trustful as well. So it always takes courage to be a team member and to move towards that community. And speak your mind. Like if don't keep stuff inside that you need to share. Okay, then the anti-pattern side. So the room behind the sauna for these. First, let's invite everyone. How much time do I have? Okay, good, pretty good. So these are examples. These are examples about like when we are trying to make a decision, when we are like, within a team. The idea is like, we want to make decisions that are good and that are quick and that we carry out. And these are antipatterns against making that kind of decisions. Like, first, let's invite everyone. This is a bad idea because it's very slow. Like, if you have trouble getting everyone inside that same room, for example, this shouldn't be trouble for a small team. But when we're talking about many teams and people who are like, you know, maybe the product owner of a Scrum team who's not in the same room every day, you know, if we need to wait until we meet those people, it slows down us a lot. And I think it comes from the feeling that we need to be democratic. But you don't need to be democratic, and being democratic is not part of being a good team. So like this is a problem of you thinking that you're in the equality matching relationship when you should be in the communal sharing relationship. Another thing, let's confirm from the boss first. And this is both of these actually. There's one company I've been coaching, and they have a problem with both of these. And the bosses say that like decide yourself, and they are very happy if the teams decide by themselves. But the teams, they have the tendency to wanting to invite everyone and wanting to ask the boss. And it like, it's very slow and it may lead to bad decisions because the boss doesn't know as much as the people who are making like working with the stuff every day. And so you feel that you need approval from the authority, but you don't. And like you think you're here in the authority ranking when you should be in communal sharing. And then let's make everyone do this from now on. Like you have a good idea, and you like, oh, if only we could solve this for the entire company, of you, if only we could solve this for the entire project. Well, we can. We decide now that let's make this a rule, and everyone should follow this from now on. And that's that. It doesn't work that way because like if you are in the communal sharing mode. Like on one side, it means that you should be able to make decisions that affect the whole team. On the other, it means that maybe the others don't think the same way, if they are not present in that situation. And it's slow again. Like if we have to create a process out of something, it's very slow compared to just doing the stuff. And so like you are now trying to either command or convince the other people to do what you decided. Within that smaller team or by yourself, and like you are trying to like use authority ranking or market pricing in that situation. It's when you should be using communal sharing. Last one, we should do something about this. This is the worst one, I think. It's like do or do not. It's when you have a conversation within your team and you it ends up in a situation like where or. Like someone says we should do something about this, and everyone's yeah. That's the worst kind of conversation. It's you are building a backlog of stuff that you should do, but you're not doing. So either decide that we're not going to do that, and it's very easy. Like you just say no, we're not going to do that, and then or like do it right away. Decide that okay, we do it right away, or you know at most like put it in the backlog, and then do it next week. Or really soon, but don't put it like at the end of the backlog. Like it's if it's at the end of the backlog, then you're never going to do that. And so, try stop accumulating decisions. Make it, and this is the key to that. Like when you have that conversation where you end up like we should do something or we could do something, like decide that no, we're not going to do that, or sometimes that let's do it right away. And so, like here, I think the question is that you expect there's like that there's some kind of a real decision-making process, like that like we are just talking now, and we shouldn't really be making this kind of a big decision at this point. But there is no real decision-making process. Not even like if you're working in that communal sharing mode, it means that like there's no authority ranking anymore. Which is like that's not the real decision-making process anymore. There's no market pricing. There's not the negotiation part. You should just make the decision, and there's no voting. So you should be here and make the decision right away. Right? And I think that's the point of teamwork. Like there is no decision-making process beside the team, and like these tools, these anti-patterns. Avoiding them and using these tips, then you can make the team work even when there is no like, formal decision-making process. And that's all I have. Any questions? Yep, okay.
Hi. All these things, the tips, they assumes that people who work together, they are close to each other and maybe not only in work, in the life position and their meanings. And what if people are different who work together, maybe to some vegetarians, meat eaters together, racist niggers.
So, the thing I started with was that you need to, in order to cooperate, you need to have that feeling of fairness, and that comes from using the same model in your communication within the people in the same project or people you collaborate with in your work. And I think like that's the starting point. That's the, you need to have that. If you can, you move as much as you can to the communal sharing part. So, you know, yeah. Like if this is not possible for reason or another, you cannot work here or you cannot make some decisions here. You move as much as you can, maybe, like, and do that stuff here. But then, like the stuff that you cannot do there, you use equality matching or the re-ranking or whatever. And these tips, they like yeah, like this is not an exhaustive list. So, I mean, you can think of other stuff. These are just examples that I felt that are important and people often neglect. And yeah, these work very well when you have a team that's co-located, that's like equal in like or people who are in the same life situation, so they can again choose, you know, outside work activities that mesh together with their lives. Yeah, that's true. And if that's not true, then you have to find other ways to do that the same, to do the same thing. Another thing that I like when I, you know, when I say that you move stuff out of there, I don't mean you have to do it that you'd have to really think about it this way and you know like what kind of relationships I have and what kind of situations we have and which relationships should we use in each situation. I mean like this is just a like way of thinking, and when you notice a situation that someone is maybe using market pricing and using communal sharing as the model in that situation, that this is okay, now we have that problem maybe, and then you know then like this kind of thinking helps you solve that. Okay, good. Anything else? Yes, one.
I have a small comment.
Yep.
First, because I have also worked with this communal sharing model, and the best thing I found out about this is that when the decisions are made, everybody who participated, he or she was the one who also made this decision, and as a resulting, everyone has this, you know, this fire to start working, this enthusiasm.
Yeah.
And comparing with, for example, authority ranking, quite often is that the order you have, you don't really maybe agree with it, or you have no sometimes a chance to discuss it. But the downside of communal sharing for me was that sometimes this decision making and this consensus can lead to an hours of talking, because everyone has a right to speak, and if someone don't agree, then we have to just talk and talk and talk, and finally very few work is done, but a lot of exhausting talking has been done. So maybe you have a comment on this decision making of this consensus.
Well, within this model, the fact that like everyone has a right to comment and everyone has like that's really equality matching. Like everyone has the same. I can say it's not necessary from communal sharing. I think the. Oops. Oh well. Maybe this. So, what was I going to say? It's maybe part of this. Like, let's invite everyone. What you're thinking about that way. And then part of this, like we should do something about this, but not enough action. And one way to fight this, that you should always know that the decisions that you are making in this community or this team, they are not final necessarily. Like they are decisions, but the team can always change its mind later. And so that's one thing that helps, may help, that like we make this decision now. Like for example, when I said that like decide do it or don't do it, but don't don't live to the should state. When you decide that you don't do it, or you can decide next week that you do it. I mean, it's not a final decision. It's just that means that you are not actively thinking about it anymore. So and this might help you. To understand that these decisions, in the end, it's not the like we don't have to reach a final decision now, but we need to find a decision that gets us forward. But I know the situation. I know I know the type of situation, and I know it's not always easy.
So, as we all know, in every group there are people who are better working alone than in a group, though they are in a group and they contribute. Do you really try to get those people also to participate in the events? Because whenever you try to, there will always be the borderline when you try too much. The person who is actually good at working and he's already defined, I'm going to work with you, but by this time I have my family, I have this, and knock it off.
No, I don't think it's practical to think that you could in all teams work in this way and you know, always go together.
Also,
that's part of the first part of the speech. Like the most important thing is that you have you understand that in this conversation with this person we use this model in this situation and that the understanding is somehow shared, not explicitly necessarily. Well, I don't think it should be explicit, but you notice the situations when there are different expectations about how this relationship should work and find a way and mend those problems and then still gravitate towards communal sharing whenever you can.
I have a question. So you started about the salary, and is it also property of this model? And in this case, the communal team, how it's divided the salary?
So what team?
You start your presentation speaking about the money and speaking about how the money are shared. Yeah. So as I understand, market prices, of course, you get the salary of a market price
right,
salary.
Right.
So, and the question is how the salary defined in communal sharing?
Communal sharing. Like this was the, like I don't think it's. I don't think you should use communal sharing to pay salaries. Like this is the point from the. That I think practically it's some combination of these. Like in my company all the founders have the same share, so we are using equality matching in that. Then everyone gets the, based on their market value, which is partly certainly based on rank and seniority, because that's what people expect. So I think with salaries as well, it's not a question like what is the right salary. It is a question what is a fair salary, and what is fair that depends on how people come to that situation, how they view it, and if you think about if you only think about what is the correct salary, then you're thinking in market pricing terms, really. What is the market value of this person? So you should understand, and as a boss, you should understand that people come to salary negotiations with very different mindsets. Some of them expect this. Like we are colleagues, we should get the same salary. Some of them expect this. You know, I've been here for 10 years, I should get a high salary. And some of them expect this. And you just treat different people differently. Because it's hard to, because salaries are often not public. Usually not public. It means that there is no common culture usually in the company regarding the salaries, because it's always the culture between the person who decides the salary and the person who is asking for the salary. So that's why there is even in one company there can be many very very different relationships regarding the salary.
There are companies that are
Yeah. I know, like Semco is the famous example. Yeah, it would be like, I think it works for them to like it drives them towards communal sharing, and that's maybe one kind of a communal sharing. It's like because people set their own salaries and show them to others, then they are in effect taking money from the common pool, and it's like they are doing it in a way that fits the rules kind of the community. So yeah, so that's actually an answer to that question also.